Resolution 24-386, calling for an immediate and permanent mutual ceasefire in Israel and Gaza.
Thank you. Ms. Johnson, before you begin, I'd like to just preface your item. I appreciate and welcome back our visitors here in chambers today. Ms. Johnson is bringing forward a resolution that will represent a major departure from what our council typically does. I appreciate her thoughtfulness in working on this over the last several days, and also the thoughtfulness of our council members who have been here with you all in chambers, who have had meetings with constituents around the block and around the several weeks. I want to just apologize for and acknowledge that this process has created a lot of stress and frustration in an already stressful time, and my hope is that by the end of this discussion, we are on a more optimistic path where our city is clear where we stand. So with that, Ms. Johnson, I pass this to you.
Thank you, Councilmember, Council President Jalali. What I will do as well, so as for individuals to be able to read this into the record before I make a motion to approve, I want folks to understand that the process to kind of bring forth this took a lot of communication, time, and deliberation that I actually feel is reflective of the work that the council will be doing in the future, as well as the work that we are currently doing. And I just want to acknowledge that each week, I have had the privilege of being able to see members, some who come in, some who maybe this is your first time, but some of you whom are returning. And so in this case, I would like to read, just for the sake of folks understanding what the language says, Resolution 24386 for the record. Calling for an immediate and permanent mutual ceasefire in Israel and Gaza. Whereas, when we speak as the city council, we must unify our city and not divide it. And whereas, in this moment, we are especially concerned for the health and welfare of our Palestinian, Israeli, Muslim, and Jewish inhabitants who are deeply hurting. And whereas, the killing of the Palestinian, Israeli civilians and the targeting of civilians, no matter their faith or ethnicity, is a violation of international humanitarian law and a violation of Geneva Conventions. And whereas, our community mourned the horrific acts on October 7, 2023, perpetuated by Hamas that resulted in the death of over 1,100 Israelis, with more than 200 Israeli civilians taken hostage. And whereas between October 7, 2023 and March 5, 2024, the government of Israel's response through ongoing bombing and military strikes in Gaza has now killed at least 30,000 Palestinians, who are overwhelmingly civilian men, women, and children, and severely wounded countless more. And whereas on October 26, 2023, the United Nations General Assembly, in a near unanimous vote, called for an immediate and sustained humanitarian ceasefire. And whereas on December 12, 2023, the United Nations General Assembly passed with 153 countries in favor of a resolution calling for an immediate humanitarian ceasefire in Gaza, the immediate and unconditional release of all hostages, and ensuring humanitarian access. And whereas on March 4, 2024, the United Nations Office of the Special Representatives of the Secretary General on Sexual Violence in Conflict verified credible claims of sexual violence on October 7, 2023 against Israeli civilians and hostages and is urging a formal investigation. And whereas the United Nations Agency for Palestinian Refugees has estimated that 70% of the civilian infrastructure in Gaza has been destroyed and severely damaged, including hospitals, schools, homes. And whereas hundreds of thousands of lives are at imminent risk of death by continued violence, starvation, lack of medical treatment, or lack of public health and sanitation. If a mutual ceasefire is not achieved, basic needs and infrastructures are not restored, and humanitarian aid is not delivered without delay. And whereas, an immediate and permanent mutual ceasefire creates the safest conditions for all parties involved, including the return of the remaining Israeli hostages, and ensures humanitarian aid can be delivered to Palestinians at the rate that's needed, preventing further loss of life. And whereas all forms of bigotry, violence, and oppression serve to divide our communities and weaken our effort to achieve collective safety, justice, and true multi-ethnic, multiracial democracy here and everywhere. And whereas the continued violence is being felt by our Jewish and Palestinian neighbors here in St. Paul, many with direct personal connections to the region and people at risk. And our council and city leadership are united in protecting our residents against the acts of anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, or hate crimes towards our Arab, Israeli, Jewish, and Muslim neighbors. And whereas, we joined over 70 municipalities in the United States, including Hastings, Columbia Heights, and Minneapolis here in Minnesota, in taking a stand of the interests of humanity and the well-being of our constituents. And whereas, we recognize the right of peace and safety for both the Israeli and Palestinian people, as well as for our residents here in St. Paul. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City of St. Paul calls upon our U.S. congressional delegation, both in the Senate and the House of Representatives, to join us in, number one, urging the Biden administration to immediately call for and facilitate de-escalation and a permanent mutual ceasefire to urgently end the current violence. And number two, urging the Biden administration to promptly facilitate the entry of humanitarian assistance of our administration as promised at the scale needed into North and South Gaza. And number three, ensuring the immediate release of all Israeli hostages taken by Hamas and the release of thousands of Palestinians unjustly imprisoned or held by Israel. And number four, condemning the use of murder, kidnap, and rape by Hamas on October 7th, 2023, and since. Number five, urging the Biden administration to hold international law and the January 26, 2024 order of the International Court of Justice by discontinuing unconditional U.S. military aid to Israel without clear guarantees for civilian safety. And be it further resolved, we, the St. Paul City Council, as local leaders, are urging our voices in cause for peace and to stand firmly against the rise of and all acts of racially motivated violence and hate crimes perpetuated against our Arab, Jewish, Muslim, and Israeli and Palestinian constituents here in St. Paul and around the United States. And be it finally resolved, we, the St. Paul City Council, ask the Office of the City Clerks forward a copy of this resolution to our United States House of Representatives, Congresswoman Betty McCollum, our United States Senator Tina Smith, our United States Senator Amy Klobuchar, and our United States President Joseph Biden as St. Paul's federal elected officials with the most direct and primary responsibility to our constituents on this issue.
Thank you, Councilman Johnson, for bringing this forward. Do you have a motion for us?
I do have a motion. I'm asking for the motion to be to approve resolution 24368.
Before we approve, is there any discussion?
386. Excuse me.
Before we approve, is there any discussion? Go ahead, Ms. Jost.
Thank you, Council President. Thank you so much, Councilmember Johnson. I just wanted to share some of my thoughts. I'm truly honored to serve as a city council member for the city of St. Paul. In the first 8 weeks at this new job, I spent a lot of time reflecting on what is my job as a city council member. It's always my job to listen and understand all of my constituents, no matter if we agree or we disagree, and no matter who they are or what part of the ward that they live in. It's my job to find ways to unite our community through difficult times, around difficult issues and circumstances. It is my job to lead our community through solving problems with an eye on a path forward that is inclusive and fair to all concerned. On the campaign trail, I often talked to folks about how intimate city politics are to the community and that your council member is the elected official that is closest to you and that you should feel comfortable reaching out to them in your time of need. I believe my constituents deserve to know what my values are, where I stand, and that I will be accountable for, which I am assigned. For several weeks, we've heard from many constituents with concerns about our council, remaining focused on, the matters of the city. We've heard from faith leaders across our community. We've heard from constituents with many feelings of fear and pain and hearts broken regarding the loss of life in Gaza and Israel and the need they feel to have their desire for peace heard. I know what it's like to feel powerless, hopeless, fearful, and uncertain about the future. I believe everyone in our communities deserves to feel seen and heard by the elected officials that they have trusted to lead them. Everyone in our communities deserves to feel safe, free from the fear of anti-Semitism and Islamophobia. Across the range of concerns and responses we've heard, the hope they all share is a call for peace, leadership, and a path forward that brings us together. I believe that the language and the values in this resolution achieve that goal, and I'm proud to support it.
Ms. Johnson.
And I simply want to just also echo the same sentiments. One of the things that I've been reflecting on a lot of over the last few days as far as multiple conversations with our colleagues has been the role that time can play and the role that governance should play. I'm really excited and very proud of the fact that when we had a chance to fully dive into topics of discussion, especially over the last 4 weeks, as it relates to what has been happening, the many, many lives lost, the many lives taken, we basically have to make a choice as a city council member in my eyes and the values that I hold, especially for the constituents that I represent. I find that at times, time is actually okay to take when you're developing issues that are so strong that can move in one way or another and so often end in divisiveness. I find as a city council member that the language that we have today, in hopes that it will continue to gain the supports of our colleagues, to be a step forward and not a step back, but more so multiple steps forward into what I hope to continue to be the case, both internationally as well so as locally, and that's unity, that's cohesiveness, that's getting on board and sometimes taking forms of negotiation in order to not have divisiveness foster in multiple places. And I want that here in the workplace. I want that for our constituents here in St. Paul. And when we look at that, what that conversation can look like, it's not just a yes or no often. Usually, it's what is in between and where are the places that we can actually agree on, because I hear you say a lot of things. And so I've tried to find, and what you even see here is a direct result of that. It wasn't one way or another. It intentionally wasn't a yes or no. It intentionally wasn't to take whatever side's proceeding from places. It was to find the places that not only our council members had alliance, but the community members that you see in this room, as well throughout the city of St. Paul. And so I'm really excited to be able to do my job today, which I think is taking a chance, having tough conversations, putting ourselves out there as well, listening to community members, and being willing to take feedback. And I find that to be the sole job when it comes to a public servant. At the end of the day, we serve over 46,000 constituents in our base. Not only that, we have to answer to a lot of St. Paulites. And I hope the individuals see that and the road ahead, because I see it in this room and not right now.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson, for your comments. Any other discussion on this motion? Ms. Yang, and then Ms. Kim, and then Ms. Bowie, and then Ms. Naker. Thank you.
Thanks, Council President. I first want to say thank you to those of you who have been coming to the council chambers and packing our chambers for the past 5 weeks now. I see you and see how passionate you are and how deeply you also understand our liberation is tied to each other. Like whether, you know, we are here locally in St. Paul or, you know, talking about the war happening overseas in Gaza. I think that, you know, that's something that I've been super grounded in, not only in this conversation about a ceasefire resolution, but also in my political work and organizing work as a whole, because that when I think about what humanity is all about, it is understanding that what hurts you is also what hurts me, and that our liberation is tied to each other. And so I wanted to uplift that, because I really think that, you know, that's really what brought folks together. It's that, you know, we do not stand for genocide, for war, but we are about how we can support and protect one another. And also, you know, really understanding that, you know, in war, there really is no one who wins at all. And, you know, so many of you are super clear about that, and that's why you've been here at the chambers, super clear about your values. And I want to say thank you, because it really is that persistence that has pushed our council here to be able to get to this place too. And what I want to just be really candid about, you know, as a council member to my colleagues, is that I'm really proud that we can get to this moment. I knew that we could get here. Also, what I want to ask is, I want to ask for us to not have a repeat of what happened in the past 5 weeks, because working together collectively is absolutely important. And we've done that before with previous resolutions, and it meant that we should have done that for this resolution too. And you know that's, you know, a huge learned lesson is that silence doesn't make the issue go away. It actually is going to be what energizes people because people are looking for clarity from what this body wants. And I want us to do better and be better from here on out. That's what I'm committed to, and that's what I also ask from my colleagues too. So I want to share that, you know, today I will be supporting this resolution. I think that it was long overdue for us to be able to get here. But again, I'm proud that we are able to get here today and that this is not a resolution that is perfect. I want to name that one of the things that I feel is strongly missing is the historical context that the ongoing bombardment... in the Gaza Strip comes in the context of the 75-year displacement of Palestinians. And in 2016, the United Nations Security Council found the settlements in the occupied West Bank, which have gone on for 56 years, unlawful, and the 17-year blockade of Gaza. What I read there, it's a clause that came from the Minneapolis resolution that passed. And I absolutely feel it would have been very important for us to include that in our resolution here. But you know what, even though it's not in our resolution here, I want to say thank you to our colleagues in Minneapolis and other cities who had the courage and the boldness to be able to name the true historical context that needs to be uplifted. And I want to name that for me, you know.
Excuse me. People are respectfully listening. Please model that too. Thank you.
Is that this is about liberation of all people and that we cannot, you know, reach liberation until it's also Palestinians who are liberated too. And so I want to say thanks to everybody for your work in getting the council here, for the clarity that you bring to the table, and that I'm really proud to be a supporter of this resolution.
Thank you, Ms. Yeh. All right. Go ahead. I believe we will now hear from Ms. Kim.
Yeah, thank you.
And then Ms. Bowie, and then Ms. Naik.
I just want to extend my graciousness to Councilmember Johnson for leading this effort and bringing something forward that feels still very powerful and clear. So I speak today as a vessel for the pain of my Korean ancestors whose homeland is divided. My ancestors and the people of Gaza share common enemies, namely imperialism and colonization. When I look at the history of Palestine, I see reflections of my own ancestral history. The intentional destruction of food systems, art, ecosystems, the environment, schools and temples, the destruction of safety, inherent culture, the erasure of sacred traditions and religion. My Korean ancestors revolted against Japanese occupation and US imperialism because they deserved liberation. Palestinians deserve the same.
All right.
Violence does not erupt in a vacuum. For over 70 years, the Palestinian people have been living under military occupation, restricted movement, police and military brutality, attacks from Israeli settlers, and the cruel withholding of the most basic necessities for human survival, like water, food, medical aid, and electricity, are just some of the things Gazans have been subject to. To date, over 30,000 Gazans have died due to starvation, untreated medical conditions, and by attacks from Israeli forces. It's both appalling and unsurprising that this genocide of Palestinians is being funded, armed, and shielded by the U.S. The responsibility is on our federal delegation to use their power and our country's foreign policy to bring an end to the assault and occupation in Gaza. A ceasefire is necessary to provide relief on the ground and to allow for humanitarian aid, but we also must immediately stop selling weapons to Israel.
Thank you. I want to be clear. I know there's passion. I know there's. I just want to keep things in an orderly fashion so we can hear these important points. I really do appreciate that there's a lot of emotion in the room. Thank you. Just want to make sure we can hear people. That's all. Go ahead, Ms. Kim.
Our collective humanity is responsible for raising our voices, organizing effectively, filling the gaps in our political education, and building a sense of collective responsibility for our neighbors here and abroad. We know we do not gain freedom by appealing to the conscience of our oppressors. Every single one of us must do everything we can, whenever we can, however we can. This last year, I've been centering grief as a point of entry to much of what is happening in the world. So many of us grieve, not for what we have lost, but for what we have never had. From my ancestors to the people of Palestine, free, free Palestine.
All right. We'll now hear from Ms. Bowie. Go ahead, Ms. Bowie.
Thank you, Council President. Thank you. I just want to just say I appreciate everyone who's here today, everyone who is taking time out of their day to make sure that this is an urgent matter. I just want to say thank you to all my council members. Thank you to Council Member Johnson for bringing forth this resolution that we've all been, in a spirit of collaboration, ensuring that we have active listening. I, over the weeks, have been in living rooms, at coffee shops, at libraries, in the grocery stores, talking with countless of my constituents about this issue. And I just want to make very clear that this is not an issue that I have to ignore. This is not an issue that does not matter. This is an issue that needed time to process to ensure that I am using my powers accurately, and I'm also giving the time for us to have compassion and empathy and ensure that we are going through every single chain of command when it comes to making sure that this issue and this resolution is not only passed, but has the support that is necessary for the children of Gaza and also our brothers and sisters, our Jewish brothers and sisters. Everyone I've talked to have had a common thread, right? A strong desire to stop the killings of civilians in Israel and Gaza. I haven't met anyone that says that they want to take a stance on either side. Everyone I've talked to said that there are human beings who did not sign up for war, who should not have to be casualties of war. There are also human beings who have said that we should not expect children to distinguish bread from bombs. And in the same way, growing up in St. Paul, I should not have grown up having to distinguish gunshots from fireworks, right? Violence everywhere is unacceptable. Early on, I'll be honest and transparent about my journey. Early on in my journey as a councilwoman for St. Paul City Council, I strongly believe that this issue was something just for Congresswoman Betty McCollum, right? Or this issue was for something for U.S. Senator Tina Smith, or this issue was U.S. Senator Amy Klobuchar should address. But during my campaign trail, not once was I asked about this form of action or how the council would take this up. But I am not an expert on war. I am not an expert on foreign affairs, but I am an expert on humanity. And I think all of us understand the gruesome crimes against humanity that we have witnessed, starvation, killings.
Rape of Jewish women, babies, burning.
Please stop yelling over people speaking. This is not respectful. Our council is working to play back what we have heard. If you continue to speak over people talking from the chambers, I will ask you to be removed, whoever you are. We are trying to make sure everyone is heard. Thank you. Go ahead, Ms. Bowie.
Thank you. And taking on all these different forms of actions, hearing from people who wanted us to take a form of action by way of a resolution, I think this is literally the least we can do, in our powers. In a capacity, in my other capacity, I am a former fellow for the United Nations Office of Human Rights for the People of African Descent. I have maximized all the ways that I can lend my voice to that by submitting testimonies to the UN, alerting our form of people of African descent to address this issue. We heard already in this resolution legislation about that passing with the majority. Many of my colleagues through the UN and Office of Human Rights have asked for, you know, for people who are in this room who call themselves activists to have equitable attention to all genocide, right? To the genocide of the Africans in Congo, in Nigeria, in Malaysia. And in closing, I want to address here, because I'm an artist, and I believe that, you know, humanity and art is our universal language. There's this poem that I've been reading and just reflecting on that I want to share, if you may. It's called First They Came. First They Came. First they came for the communists, and I did not speak out because I was not a communist. Then they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unions, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me. Then they came for the Palestinians, and I did not speak out. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak out for me. So the spirit of what we're doing right now through this resolution is to ensure that we are standing up for everyone and that we are St. Paul, but we are also a global society. We are a global citizens. We have family members all across the globe. And the people who are here with signs, I've came here with signs saying that this is a local issue, there is truth to that. Because we are a global society, and when there's an attack on one of us, there is an attack on all of us. In the process of drafting this resolution, along with my colleagues, has taught me the incredible amount of grief and trauma and pain that many of our family members are holding. And they should not have to hold that alone. And they're experiencing and witnessing the most gruesome crimes against humanity, and has taught me the importance of our services here in St. Paul to ensure that people have access to information, people have access to the internet, people have access to safe spaces, and people have access to send their griefness to where they should have bear their grievances. A ceasefire resolution is an ode to the people power that has grown in this room to ensure that we cannot wait any longer. Enough is enough. This war has gone too far, and this is not a stance on Israel or Gaza. This is a stance for humanity. And I just want to say thank you.
All right, Ms. Naker, I welcome you to speak. Thanks,
Council President. I want to join my colleagues in thanking everyone who is here today and people who have been taking time to show up and to contact us on this issue over many, many weeks and months. I also want to say how much I respect each of my colleagues around this table. I especially want to thank Councilmember Yang for your leadership, Councilmember Johnson for your leadership, and Council President, you and I have disagreed on this issue and other issues, and you do not deserve to have your name on those signs that are up right now. I understand firsthand the pain that has brought people to our chambers week after week. I had to tell my children that they lost their favorite teacher when he was killed on October 7th. And so many of us in this room have lost friends and family and countless community members. What is going on in Israel and Gaza is an unspeakable horror that we all pray must come to an end. I continue to believe that passing resolutions on international matters is not what we were elected to do. As many of our constituents have said, complex international issues with, in this case, thousands of years of history, are simply beyond our capacity as local elected officials to fully understand, and they distract from more immediate issues that are our responsibility to address. I also believe that in times like this, when so many in our community are in pain, it's our job as elected officials, as many of my colleagues have said, to bring people together, not to divide people, and that resolutions that are not done carefully and well have great potential to do just the opposite. That said, I join my colleagues in wanting to acknowledge the immense pain that has led people to demand action and in wanting to lay out our stance as a city council. And I am deeply grateful for the way that our council has worked through this challenging issue, that we have listened to and been honest with one another. We've been personal with one another. We've checked in with our community members of all backgrounds. And ultimately, I believe we have drafted a resolution that is by far more fair, nuanced, and justified than any that I have seen to date. We have done this our own way. We have done this the St. Paul way. And I believe this resolution can help unite our community rather than further divide it, which has to be our ultimate goal. And finally, I hope that what we, as a diverse, young, new council, have been able to do to get here in our first 8 weeks in this job together, embracing our rich diversity of backgrounds and approaching each other with humility and with empathy and actually trying to hear each other, is what we can all find the strength to do in all of our communities as we navigate this incredibly challenging time together, and I will be voting yes.
Thank you, Councilman Naker. I would like to, I'll close by saying the following. It's been a really, it's been a formative journey to be the council president during this time in our country's history. As a Middle Eastern American person, as an Iranian and Korean woman, my family shares the heritage that Councilmember Kim described. My family was displaced because of American colonialization, because of imperialism in 1979. My family has experienced the destabilization of the Middle East because of US foreign policy. And I have also had to run this council table and hold the pain of our community coming from all directions. There's a great community leader, Chantel Allen, who's a school board member. She was talking to me this week and she said, sometimes, Mitra, in this job, you just have to hold the pain. And I thought about that because that's what I've been reflecting on. I want to acknowledge it maybe hasn't come off that way. I can see why you would think that, but quietly we have been quiet in ways because we're listening and processing, because we have been looking for a way to send a clear message that both Twin Cities support a permanent mutual ceasefire. Both Twin Cities expect our federal government to take all of this anguish and to make better choices, better than the past foreign policy they have wrought, a foreign policy that I'll speak for myself, I believe, to have been essentially funding crimes against the Palestinian people and occupation, turning a blind eye, allowing journalists to be murdered, and saying nothing as democracy erodes in the very government of Israel. And this is a time to be brave right now for our United States representatives. This is a time for a president to be brave, and I know that Minnesota sent a message yesterday with 46,000 voters who said we are not committed. And I think our council is special because unlike any other council in the state, we have a Jewish member. We have an Iranian, a Middle Eastern elected member. We have entirely women of different backgrounds connected by these big picture things. We are the only country council in the country that made national news for all being women. We were elected to care for our community and to also hold our federal government accountable to their job and their part in that. And what I see this resolution as is one, an evolution of our council members from, I think, agreeing largely on the issue, but not clear on the pathway to uplift what you want, to now today, where I think that in a way, the fact that something has been drafted where you can hear the different ways we talk about this all around the table, there's no prevailing viewpoint, but there is a consensus viewpoint that is very clear and undeniable, and that is what we are asking our federal government to do in a way that makes it very clear. We appreciate their partnership as local government partners, and we also know that you can't appreciate in one hand and suffer anguish in the other, right? So we're asking for them to listen. I hope that you take the fight to their elections, to dialogues with them. We will be bringing this resolution to them. And I think it is very notable that this council appears to be about to pass it unanimously. So with that, I would close by just saying our process for this is challenging by design in that these items under our charter don't have public hearings. What we have done is tried to treat the entire last 3 months as one big, long public hearing of hearing from people, listening to constituents in meetings, emails, conversations at events, everything. So my hope is that you can walk out of here and we are able to say the Twin Cities stand for a ceasefire. So with that, we have a motion. Ms. Kim, is the motion, oh yeah. Motion from Ms. Johnson to approve. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
Seven in favor, no one opposed. The resolution is adopted.